Okay, gentlemen, welcome to SPLN 101. This is Principles of Speech. It's a public speaking course, absolutely essential for anything you intend to do in life, and I believe it will be an absolutely transformational experience for me, if not for all of you as well. This is the very first time I'm teaching this course. It's a little bit outside of my area of expertise. I'm actually a historian. I do most of my stuff in Jewish history. But for reasons that perhaps will become clear over the course of this semester, I've decided I'd like to teach this course anyways. How many of you already know how to speak? Okay, we have two brave or three, but yeah. I would hazard a guess that if you were accepted to the college, at least if you had an interview, you would know how to speak. So the question is, why are you here if you already know how to speak? Because your parents forced you, because you want to get into a graduate school. Now, someone give me an honest answer. Why are you here if you already know how to speak? I'm sorry?
It's a college core.
It's a college core. Very good. They forced me to take this course. Please tell me your last name.
Kramer.
Mr. Kramer. Very good. Okay. Mr. Kramer says, well, I'm forced to, so I have to do it. Anyone else? Is there possibly a benefit? Is the wisdom of the curricular designers somehow inherent in this classical course? Mr. Kramer, what do you think besides that?
You all have problems with speaking, so you're here to help us.
Okay, biggest room in the world is room for improvement. And that's kind of like a cliche, but it says a lot about what we're going to be doing here. Everyone, for example, already knows how to walk. But, you know, if you want to run a marathon, if you want to keep up with a fast person, if you want to walk with posture, with balance, and if you want to express your personality in your walk, if you're flat-footed, you know, you're pigeon-toed, these are all reasons why you might go to a walking coach. And even though you can probably get from point A to point B without any assistance, nevertheless, there are ways to do it much better. And if that's true about walking, how much more so is it relevant for speaking? Because speaking is really what truly makes us human. This course is going to focus on how to speak like a mensch. Obviously, we're going to get into primarily business applications of speech. We're going to be talking about presentations. We're going to talk about persuasive speech. We're going to be talking about interview skills. We're going to be talking about a certain amount of interpersonal communication, but primarily one-to-many kind of communications that you will need no matter what kind of area of professional development you go into after you leave these, you know, hallowed halls of Touro College. If you're going to be a doctor or a medical professional, you're going to have to know how to talk to, unfortunately, grieving families. You're going to have to know how to express yourself and use your entire body in a way that conveys the deeper emotion of what you're trying to express at the same time as you communicate to them the content of the message that you have to deliver. So it's a really essential factor, not only in your professional development, but also, I would hazard, in your human development. Let's just look at a classic text. I'm sure some of you have occasionally seen this text. It comes around once a year. Hashem creates the human being and says here, "Vayipach bapav nishmas chayim." Right? Someone want to translate that phrase for me? Very good. He breathed into him the soul of life. What's your name, sir?
Shmuel,
last name?
Adelson.
Mr. Adelson, good. Vayihi Adam lenefesh chaya. Mr. Adelson?
His name was for a living soul.
Very good. What does this mean, nefesh chaya? A living soul. It's a good translation, Mr. Adelson. We should all give him a hand. Okay, very good. Superior to an animal. Okay, where do you get that?
Rashi.
Rashi, very good. Rashi is not on this selection. Something else is on this selection.
Unculus,
right, Uncle Lewis. What does Unculus have to say? How does he translate that? It's right here. L'ruach memalala. Okay, how's your Aramaic?
Filled.
That would be male would be good, right? Oh, I forgot. It has this cool thing. This is a smart board. Look at that. Isn't that great? Okay. Ruach, of course, is the same in Hebrew. It's spirit. Memalala. This is one of the most common words in the Aramaic Bible. Translates the word vayomer, or lemor, actually. Memalala. Help me out.
To say.
To say. Good. So please translate. L'ruach memalala.
Spirit to say.
A spirit of speech. Spirit of speaking. All right. Very good. Thank you. What's your last name again?
Buchinger.
Mr. Buchinger. Let's have a big hand for Mr. Buchinger. Very good. So the translation of Nefesh Chaya, a living soul, is the spirit of speech. And as Rashi picks up, of course, this is what primarily distinguishes us from the animal kingdom, that we use speech to express complex ideas. Now, animals do communicate as well, lots of sources in the Gemara as well, for this idea. But the idea of speech, that's something that truly distinguishes us as humans. So in many ways, what we're going to talk about in the next few weeks is how we're going to refine and develop our speaking skills, which are really the essence of our humanity. The very first descriptor, really, of what is a human being has to do with speech. Okay? Now, check this out. With this smart board, I can just erase the whole thing, right? Look at that. I love these smart boards. We got to get some next door. Okay, let's go to the next screen here. Let's have a look just for a second. This is a rather brilliant speaker. Anyone recognize the face? Very good. Dr. Martin Luther King. This is his famous mountaintop speech, the last speech. We're just going to look at it for a second because he illustrates a lot of the concepts that I want to get across in this class. Basically, I want you to focus on three basic elements of speaking. It's all over the board. It's on your syllabus. You'll see it everywhere. Public speaking, to my mind, really is composed of three basic elements. One is content, which means what is it that you're trying to say? What is the message? The second is context. It's incredibly important that you recognize to whom are you speaking? In what setting? For what purpose? These are the contextual factors are huge. And then finally, there is the instrument. We'll talk about what the instrument is in a few minutes. But what I'd like you to do is have a look at how this, in this 2-minute speech, Martin Luther King really is a master of context. He understands his crowd, and he is going to use two principal techniques. The first is going to be balanced and parallel speech, where he's going to take certain key words and repeat them. Kellyanne Conway is actually very famous for this. We'll look at her style a little bit later. And secondly, he's going to tap into the shared meaning system of his audience that I believe you gentlemen will also share, and that creates a huge resonance in terms of how he conveys his message. It's a very powerful speech. Let's have a quick look, 2 minutes.
All we say to America is be true to what you're saying on paper. Lived in China or even Russia or any totalitarian country. Maybe I could understand some of these illegal injunctions. Maybe I could understand the denial of certain basic First Amendment privileges because they haven't committed themselves to that, over that. But somewhere I read of the freedom of assembly. Somewhere I read of the freedom of speech. Somewhere I read of the freedom of press. Somewhere I read that the greatness of America is the right to protest for rights. And so that's because I say we aren't going to let any dogs or water hoses turn us around. We aren't going to let any injunction turn us around. But I don't know what will happen now. We got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now. Because I've been to the mountaintop. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you. But I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. My eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
Powerful speech. Okay, what about the balanced and parallel structure? Do you notice any repeating phrases he uses?
Somewhere I read.
Right. And any others?
Maybe.
Yeah, that's right. He uses that a couple of times as well. He says, maybe it's if I lived in China. Maybe if I lived in Soviet Russia. Right?
Freedom.
Does he use the word freedom?
Oh,
very good. That's right. That's right. Very good. There's one more I'm hoping you'll get. It's at the end. It's in this speech is called The Mountaintop. Right. Okay. Very good. He uses the mountaintop. I've been to the mountaintop. This is called the mountaintop speech or been to the mountaintop speech. So use these three times. Now, hang on a second. When he says, somewhere I read, where did he read it?
Constitution.
Does he say the word Constitution anywhere there? So what is he doing when he says, somewhere I read?
Ironic.
Right? It's an allusion. It's a little bit ironic, yeah, because he's like sort of saying it's supposed to be there, but it's not. But what is he doing by not, why doesn't he just say, I read in the Constitution or the Constitution says, Mr. Kramer?
He's trying to say that maybe it's obvious that he should know. Everyone read it.
And what happens when you are in the audience and the speaker makes an allusion like that?
It unites
because you share in that meeting. Very good. Mr. Eisenberger, is that right? No, Mr. Eisenberger's here. Mr. Adelson, Ms. Adelson, right? Okay, vowel at the beginning. Okay. This is what's called in educational theory zone of proximal development, that you just reach just above where they are, and when they catch it, the students feel like, oh my gosh, I'm getting it, I'm moving up, I'm learning this. So by saying, somewhere I read, and people know he's talking about the Constitution, it involves them in his meaning structure. What about the mountaintop bit? What mountaintop is he talking about? Yeah, what is the biblical reference? Well, not exactly Har Sinai, but close. Har Nevo. Right, just on the outside of Israel, and he looks over, right? And so what does that make him, by the way, if he's on Har Nevo looking over into Eretz Yisrael? Yeah, he's making the Moses, right? And so in the African-American tradition, the whole idea of, you know, go down Moses, so Moses goes and speaks to Pharaoh and tells them he has to let my people go, you know, that really resonated with them. You could hear it in the audience. So there's a lot of techniques going on in his speech. So even in 2 minutes, there's a lot more we can analyze here. We might come back to it later on in this class. But there's so many techniques going on that really made him an incredibly effective speaker. We might look at a few other speeches of his. But what goes into a good speech? Oh, by the way, this was his last public speech. He was, in fact, killed later on by an assassin's bullet. And it was the that reference to longevity, when he says we all like to live a long life, that is especially ironic in this context. So what are the three elements? Oh, let's talk about the syllabus now. How are we going to grade this course? I know you're all concerned about it. So have a look at the syllabus, which is here. And I'm going to show you online where you can find it on a program called Blackboard, which is our course management software. You'll be using it a lot. Basically, we're going to grade this course with no tests and no exams. But you will be speaking every single class, and you will be judged by your peers. I'll explain to you how that works. 40% of your grade is going to be my assessment of your speaking skills. And since you will be speaking every single class, there's going to be a lot of data from which I can base that grade. Another 40% is going to be based on how your peers grade you as well, on the same scale. So we will have an open and transparent grading system where all of you will grade all of you, and the grades will be visible to everybody. So Since you will be grading your peers, you have to be gentle but effective, and they will be grading you in turn, right? So since we're all on the same page up front, that's how it's going to work. Now, I will also be paying attention to how you grade your peers, and I will give you a 10% grade based on how productive your comments are. And that means not just, you know, you enter into a kind of a suicide pact and everybody gives everybody 100% because I will kill you all in 10% over here. But, you know, when you, oops, sorry, I got to go back. Can I go back? When I give you the, if you say things which are helpful, like you're saying too much or things like that, it shows that you're paying attention and it's a useful kind of criticism, then I'll give you a check mark saying, good, those are useful kinds of critiques. If you read in the textbook, there's some really great discussion on exactly how to give positive feedback or negative feedback in a positive manner. And then finally, 10% will be my sort of subjective assessment, looking at the scope of your skills as they develop over the course to give you a little boost upwards. That's how we get 100% of the grade. Yes, Mr. No. Okay. All right. So is this system clear, how we're going to divide these grades? It's a little bit like, what is that? I didn't even touch it. It's a little bit like, you know, those reality TV shows, I think, where they vote people off the island or something like that. But I think it's good. Okay, how do you succeed in this course? Here's three basic rules. The path to success is one, show up all the time. Right? This is an attendance mandatory class. It's possible during the course of the year, I might want to give you some time to prepare a speech. We might cancel a class with notice in advance. But otherwise, you're expected to be here every time we meet. Obviously, you're being graded for every speech you give. The bonus is you don't have to do any tests or exams. So it's a great course for the summer in that, you know, all you got to do is show up and you'll already be 80% there, to paraphrase someone else. Second, prepare for class. You can prepare in a couple different ways. One of the most important ways is to read the textbook. We will only be loosely following the textbook, but it's an extremely useful resource. And you'll derive a lot of helpful information from it. So the textbook is available used for about $10 from a lot of online sellers. I've listed the actual ISBN and all the materials over here. It's called The Challenge of Effective Speaking. I've chosen the 15th edition, which is not the newest one. You can choose the newest one, which is probably about $150. Or you can use older ones, but the pagination will significantly be different.
On Amazon?
Yes, on Amazon, all over the place. It's a very common textbook. So that's one good way, is preparing by reading. Another way is by reviewing these prezis, which are going to be online. I'll try to put them up in advance so you can even look at them in advance, maybe watch the speeches that are embedded into the prezi in advance, whatever you like. We will also have the textbook. What's the textbook called? This prezi. We're going to talk about this at the end of today's class, P-R-E-Z-I. It's like, you know, what PowerPoint wants to be when it grows up, but it never will catch up. Okay, so another way to prepare for class, I'm going to give you in advance some assignments. So for example, on Monday, when we meet again, I would like you all to speak about a moment in your life when you were afraid. That's a theme for your speech on Monday. Share some of your fears. This is not group therapy, okay? Don't expect like some kind of feedback, but the idea is to share a moving story, and I'll give you some resources to prepare for that. And third and finally, listen to everyone. You have to show equal respect to those of us in the room who are not yet blessed with full beards, just as you would to the gray beard in front of you now. Right? Show respect for your colleagues. Lack of respect for your colleagues will be viewed with disfavor in your grades. So make sure that you give full attention, full eye contact. You know, be in the moment when your colleagues are speaking. Questions about the syllabus? Yes, Mr.
Eisenberger.
Edelstein?
Edelstein.
Sorry? Edelstein. Eisenberger.
How long should these assignments be?
The speeches?
Yeah.
If you look at the size of the room, and I figure I'm going to devote about half the class to speeches, it's probably about 1 to 2 minutes. We may have to break a few up over two classes when we get to the end of the class and you're doing the more substantive speaking. But for today, for example, you are speaking today. Speech today is going to be 1 to maximum 2 minutes. Okay? All right. Oh, wait, hang on, okay? I can't give you too much time to prepare. Okay, so let's go on. The three elements of public speaking. This is the way I look at this particular subject. And now here, let's use some of this. The first is content, which is basically what is it that you are trying to say, right? There are some aphorism. I believe the Chafetz Chaim says there's an idea that your life is measured by the number of words you utter in a lifetime. And so therefore, you want to preserve those words. You want to make sure you use them effectively. You don't want to blather on and waste your words. So the content of your talk is incredibly important. Related to the content is, of course, the organization, the manner of presentation. Like we saw with Martin Luther King Jr., he doesn't say the word Constitution. He doesn't say the word Moses, doesn't say the word Promised Land. Well, he does say the Promised Land. He says these things because he thinks he can communicate the meaning much better by only alluding to them. We'll spend next week, by the way, we'll talk a little bit about the power of silence in a public speech. So content involves both what the tochen, what the actual material is, and also the organization of the material. So we'll spend a lot of time breaking down that skill. It's in content. That will be clear now. It seems like it was a book, right? Book has words in it. The words are organized in a sequential fashion, thematic, things like that. That's in content. Context is also known as the rhetorical situation. Who are you speaking to? Why are you speaking? What is the room like? How many people are there? Are you using presentational aids? Are you using a microphone? Is it a somber event, a celebratory event? What exactly is the reason that you're opening your mouth in the first place? Context is where a lot of the art of speaking comes to play. And then finally, instrument. And I didn't define this earlier. I don't want to hazard a guess. What do I mean by instrument? Body language is good. What's your name, sir? Mr. Rogoff. Yes, there's a school of acting called Stanislavski, the Stanislavski method, in which they coined the term one's instrument, and that refers to your body. That refers to when you're an actor on the stage, and speech is a performance art, when you're an actor on the stage, you use your body in its totality. You use your body in terms of your gestures, your posture, your affect. It also extends to the tools you use, the eye contact, incredible number of things. We'll see in just a minute a little bit about vocal control. All of these things are related to your instrument. So when you get up to speak here, you're not just going to be reading off a cue card, or you're not going to be reading off a text. This is not a course in public reading. This is a course in public speaking, which is ultimately going to be very extemporaneous. So the instrument is very important, and we're going to focus on these issues as well. If you noticed, when Martin Luther King Jr. was speaking, his affect was very flat. I mean, his face was not like, you could see that there was a deep-seated anger and frustration over the injunctions that were oppressing the African Americans in the 1960s. But he was not like raging like a Hitler, and then he was just like quietly angry. It was seething anger, and it was still a determination, you know? The face showed that. You notice how he ended his speech? He it was a microphone drop, right? He just says, you know, my eyes have seen the glory of the coming Lord, and he leaves. He doesn't say in conclusion, doesn't say thank you for your attention. He ends it abruptly, right? These are all aspects of using his instrument effectively to convey the message. So those are the three things we're going to focus on in this course: content, context, and instrument. And in fact, why don't you have a look at the CCI rubric here, which is on the third page of the syllabus. This is the rubric that I'll be using and you'll be using for all the grades. Someone explain to, I don't know who said that. There we go, excellent. CCI, right? Content, you got it. Okay, so it's a simple 10-point score that you're going to be giving each other for their speeches. Content, weak is 1 point. Incoherent, unconvincing, poor citations. Yes.
Have you done the speech with some of these out?
Yes, but they're online. So if you have a smartphone with you, you can do it while they're speaking on your phone. If you want to take notes and then go to a computer later, because it's going to be an online survey that, once again, everybody will see. Okay, you're going to see your grades. You're going to see how you graded other people.
It's through the portal?
I'll show you inside in a second. It's through the portal, through Blackboard. You'll just click on the person's name. 10 questions. It shouldn't take you too long.
See who wrote.
Yes, everything is wide open, okay? So right now, no secrets.
So every day you have to fill out one for every single guy?
Correct.
They want
that. Yeah, well, would you like an exam?
No.
Okay, there we go.
You can
do it as you're speaking. Absolutely. And you can go back and correct it too. Your phones are a great way to do it. I'll show it to you online. We have to make sure we got some Wi-Fi in here. I'll see what I'm going to do about that. We have Wi-Fi. Middle of the semester, when the women leave, we're going to go over into that building where we have Wi-Fi, and it'll be a little easier. But anyways, you're going to give 1, 2, or 3 points for content. And you can see this is a guide to sort of what you think of the content. Then you have room for comments. And that's an important thing too. Give something productive to your peer. Let them try and develop so that they can get better at what they're doing. Secondly, context, which is obviously the context is going to be this room. It's going to be us. I have some ideas. We might experiment. If the weather's a little cooler, we might go out and try and speak in very different kind of environments, maybe on the street. I was thinking about maybe doing a soapbox kind of thing.
Yes.
To get a sense of what that's like, right? So the context is more the awareness of the context. Like, how clued in is the speaker to me as an audience member? Is he making eye contact with me? Is he using effective gestures? Is he providing a material that fits within the context of the assigned speech? And you'll see what's going on there. Finally, and we'll also have some exercises in how to deal with hecklers and how to deal with negative audience interactions. Finally, instrument. This is all about, proxemics, person's moving around effectively, body language, timbre, prosody, a lot of different forms of speaking and so on. And then finally, I've added a 1 point bonus at the bottom, which I call magic moment. Like, even if the speech was really not great, but there was 1 point that was excellent, you can give that magic moment point. Just say what it's for, give it away. I'll give you one example from my own life, which I think you might find entertaining. When I was about 8 years old, we had a public speaking contest in my school. And I had a rival. I was a smart kid, and he was the other smart kid in class. And he and I always traded to try and get the best marks in class. My father was never impressed. I would come home with awards, and he would say, "So what, Henry? It's a stupid class." Right? He was right. Most of the guys I went to school with ended up in jail. One of them for murdering a policeman, too. But at any rate, we had this public speaking competition. I was about 8 years old. I gave a stupid speech, and then my friend Peter Chin got up, and when he gave his speech, he was talking about the theory of evolution, Darwin, right? And at one point he says, get ready, at one point, 8 years old, he says that humans are the only primates that can touch the tips of each of their fingers with their opposable digit, with their thumbs. And just like many of you in this room, they all checked if they were in fact Homo sapiens. All the judges started going like this to make sure, yeah, look at that, I can do that, Right? So that's like a magic moment. And when I saw that, I knew I lost that competition, which I did. But it's like just one little bit of the speech that shines as something special, okay? That's how you're gonna grade each other. Okay, clear? Excellent. Let us continue then. So, here are the three things, right? You should be using now: content, context, and instrument. Let's go into this context idea a little bit. So, this is a great definition of communication that comes from your textbook. And by the way, I welcome you to take notes. certainly very helpful, but all of this is online. You can view this Prezi at any time just by going online. So the definition here is communication is the process of creating shared meaning. What does that quotation signify? Mr. Kramer, you're always there, okay?
Involving the audience, try to get what their needs
are. Very good. So involving the audience, but that's not all of it, right? Like involving, I could just like ask you guys about your day.
Kind of feeding their needs and wants.
That's the first part of it. The first part is the speaker has to like understand the audience enough to get their cooperation. He has to co-opt the audience, has to get buy-in from the audience, and then what? And influence them, right. And then in a dastardly way, get them to do what you want. Buy your product, vote for your candidate, whatever it is. There is a creation of shared meaning. I have meaning in my mind. I have an idea in my mind of what I think is true and important and beautiful. And you have something different. So the idea is I have to bring you in and share that meaning with you, and then we walk out of this room with an elevated consciousness of each other's thoughts. That's really what speech is about, communication is about, creating shared meaning. It is not a one-way street. It goes both ways, and like this diagram sort of indicates, audience speaker, there is what's called limbic feedback. Like when I see your body language, when I see your eye contact, when I see your posture, I have a sense of how well is this working? Are you receptive? Are you getting it? Or am I just, you know, talking into the wind? These are the things that we're going to work on analyzing for your own speaking. Okay, let's look at a little bit deeper. The rhetorical context, the textbook uses a little bit different phraseology for this, but basically one nice way to think of a speech is in the form of a Venn diagram. You're familiar with Venn diagrams, right? When you have like overlapping spheres of influence, and where they overlap, that's where you have something that shares from everything. So you have these three spheres, the speaker, the audience, and the occasion, the time. Why are we all together right now? Where those three things overlap is the speech. Like for example, you are here because you're forced to take this course to graduate from college. I am here because the college is paying me money. Actually, I'm not getting paid for this course, but I'm here because I work for the college and I want the college to succeed, so I want to give you a great educational experience. And the occasion is we're going to talk about public speaking. So that's what the speech is. If I were to come here and talk about the Florida Marlins, that would clearly, you know, be the wrong occasion. And you guys would wonder, why did I bother trying to get into the leading Jewish college in the world? I should have gone to, I don't know, some other college. If I were to be absent, or for you were to be absent, and you can be absent even while you're still physically in the room, then the Venn diagram doesn't work, right? We all have to come together for the speech to create that shared meaning. Okay, that's like the rhetorical context. Rhetoric, by the way, is a very important term in this sense, but we'll come to a minute. Let us also recall that much of what we're going to be focusing on is distinguishing between the signal and the noise. So what do these terms mean, the signal and the noise? What's your last name, sir?
Waldman.
Mr. Waldman. Okay, avoid eye contact when I ask a question, or else I'll ask you, what does that mean, the signal and the noise? What's the difference?
It's the way you're conducting your body and how speech comes out of it.
Nope, but good try.
Getting a feel for the audience.
Mr. Eisenberger?
Getting a feel for the audience, how they're reacting to what you're saying.
Nope, also good, but not right. How many of you ever listened to analog radios? Yeah, everybody's digital here, right? You guys are all born like in the 21st century or something. How many of you ever see videos of old TVs where they got the rabbit ears, right? What's going on? What's going on in when you're
receiving the signal?
Very good. And what happens when you're not quite getting the signal? Oh, you used the word signal. So what is the signal? The signal is the message. What's your last name, please? Mr. Sutherland, with an I. Signal is the message, right? What's got to come through? The TV show, the radio program. That's the signal. What's the noise?
Static.
The static. Excellent, Mr. Eisenberger. The static is like lots of all kinds of things. It's still there, but you got to learn to pick out the signal for the noise. And sometimes it's very difficult. The kinds of things that you might find in the signal and the noise are fear. Right? Next week on Monday, we're talking about fear. People are afraid to speak in public. And that fear is like all that noise is in your head and preventing you from effectively engaging the signal. Another one would be this internal monologue, because you cannot shut down your own self-thinking. Pia Sencha Chasidis is very big into this. That, you know, you here I am talking to you. But part of me is also, you know, like at home thinking about what my wife is making for dinner tonight. And a part of me is thinking like, you know, it's kind of hot in this room. Or I have all these like things going on in my brain. And I have to just shut those down and focus on the signal. But nevertheless, you've got, and it can also have worse things. You can also say like, oh my gosh, you know, is my fly down? You know, and you don't want to look because then everyone will know if it is down, right? Oh, and say, oh my gosh, you know, like, you know, is my hair out of place? You know, stuff like that. Whatever it is, you've got this stuff going on in your head, and you have to learn to shut it down, that internal monologue, in order to be effective. Atmospheric conditions, like we talked about temperature, the lighting in a room, the distance from the speaker to the back row, all kinds of things like that are relevant. Audience control, you guys have been pretty good. I appreciate it. Thank you very much for paying attention. But sometimes, you know, especially if you have a big audience, at the last school I taught, and I used to teach a required course with 250 students in the room. It's a very different kind of environment to try and hold the attention of 250 people at the same time in a required course that they're forced to take. But you got to learn how to deal with that kind of environment. And finally, sometimes you have a really hostile audience. I'm going to show you a very brief 36-second clip. You may even remember this because it happened about... About 6 years ago, I think, President Barack Obama is speaking to the joint sessions of the House. Probably the most important, auspicious moment of the year in terms of public speaking in this great country, where the president will address the House of Representatives and the Senate together and lay out his, or conceivably in the future, her vision for the nation, what's going on. It's the State of the Nation speech, a really important speech. And if you recall, you know what happened in that speech? Yeah, that's right. At one point, one of the representatives, in a big breach of etiquette, shouted out, "You lie." Right? And that was kind of nasty, because even if you disagree with the president, you still, you know, when you're in, you're representing your district, you have to be polite and listen to him attentively. Let's watch how he dealt with that bit of audience hostility.
The reforms I'm proposing would not apply to those who are here illegal.
Now you can imagine that moment, you know, like I think if it happened to me, I probably would have melted, you know, that would be it. Like, I would have gone ballistic, you know, but you know, he was, they used to call him No Drama Obama. He just said, you know, it's not true, and then he moved on. It's pretty impressive. Let's look at Joe Biden here. Anyone recognize these two people, by the way?
Yeah.
Who's this here?
What did that person say?
He said, "You lie." He later, by the way, apologized, and he said it was a breach of etiquette, and Obama accepted his apology. But the point for our purposes is just, how do you deal with audience hostility? We will spend more time about this later on in this course. Who's this person here? Oh, we're going to get political education, guys. Nancy Pelosi, leader of the Democratic Party in the House, I believe. Who's this guy here?
Joe Biden.
Joe Biden, right? Former vice president. Okay. Here we go. Now, the last element for our talk today, and the plan, by the way, is I'm going to wrap up in about 15 minutes. If you want, we'll take a short break, but then we're going to go straight into the one-minute speeches with grading. So let's talk through this right now. The last element, the first two is content. Second is context. Third is instrument. Here's an excellent TED talk in which the speaker goes through some basic elements of the instrument, how to use it. He starts And there's a little bit about 3 minutes. This video is about 7 minutes long. The first 3 minutes is kind of like the ethics of public speaking, which is actually kind of welcome, and it's a nice thing, and I certainly endorse it, and I expect all of you to adhere to the basic principles that he's going to espouse. But then the second half of the video is really what I mean to get across to you, which are some of the elements of using the instrument properly. Okay.
The human voice, it's the instrument we all play. It's the most powerful sound in the world, probably. It's the only one that can start a war or say, I love you. And yet many people have the experience that when they speak, people don't listen to them. Why is that? How can we speak powerfully to make change in the world? Well, I'd like to suggest there are a number of habits that we need to move away from. I've assembled for your pleasure here, seven deadly sins of speaking. I'm not pretending this is an exhaustive list, but these seven, I think, are pretty large. Habits that we can all fall into. First, gossip. Speaking ill of somebody who's not present. Not a nice habit, and we know perfectly well the person gossiping 5 minutes later will be gossiping about us. Second, judging. We know people who are like this in conversation, and it's very hard to listen to somebody if you know that you're being judged and found wanting at the same time. Third, negativity. You can fall into this. My mother, in the last years of her life, became very, very negative, and it's hard to listen. I remember one day I said to her, it's October the 1st today, and she said, I know, isn't it dreadful? It's hard to listen when somebody's that negative. And another form of negativity, complaining. Well, this is the national art of the UK. It's our national sport. We complain about the weather, about sport, about politics, about everything. But actually complaining is viral misery. It's not spreading sunshine and lightness in the world. Excuses. We've all met this guy. Maybe we've all been this guy. Some people have a blame thrower. They just pass it on to everybody else and don't take responsibility for their actions. And again, hard to listen to somebody who's being like that. Penultimate, the sixth of the seven, embroidery, exaggeration. It demeans our language, actually, sometimes. For example, if I see something that really is awesome, what do I call it? And then, of course, this exaggeration becomes lying, out and out lying, and we don't want to listen to people we know are lying to us. And finally, dogmatism. The confusion of facts with opinions. When those two things get conflated, you're listening into the wind. You know, somebody is bombarding you with their opinions as if they were true. It's difficult to listen to that. So here they are, seven deadly sins of speaking. These are things I think we need to avoid. But is there a positive way to think about this? Yes, there is. I'd like to suggest that there are four really powerful cornerstones, foundations, that we can stand on if we want our speech to be powerful and to make change in the world. Fortunately, these things spell a word. The word is hail, and it has a great definition as well. I'm not talking about the stuff that falls from the sky and hits you on the head. I'm talking about this definition, to greet or acclaim enthusiastically, which is, I think, how our words will be received if we stand on these four things. So what do they stand for? See if you can guess. The H, honesty, of course. Being true in what you say, being straight and clear. The A is authenticity, just being yourself. A friend of mine described it as standing in your own truth, which I think is a lovely way to put it. The I is integrity, being your word, actually doing what you say, and being somebody people can trust. And the L is love. I don't mean romantic love, but I do mean wishing people well. For two reasons. First of all, I think absolute honesty may not be what we want. I mean, my goodness, you look ugly this morning. Perhaps that's not necessary. Tempered with love, of course, honesty is a great thing. But also, if you're really wishing somebody well, it's very hard to judge them at the same time. I'm not even sure you can do those two things simultaneously. So hail. Also, now that's what you say, and it's like the old song, it is what you say, it's also the way that you say it. You have an amazing toolbox. This instrument is incredible. And yet this is a toolbox that very few people have ever opened. I'd like to have a little rummage in there with you now. Just pull a few tools out that you might like to take away and play with, which will increase the power of your speaking. Register, for example. Now, falsetto register may not be very useful most of the time, but there's a register in between. Now, I'm not going to get very technical about this for any of you who are voice coaches. You can locate your voice, however. So if I talk up here, my nose, you can hear the difference. If I go down here in my throat, which is where most of us speak from most of the time. But if you want weight, you need to go down here to the chest. You hear the difference? We vote for politicians with lower voices. It's true. Because we associate depth with power and with authority. That's register. And we have timbre. It's the way your voice feels. Again, the research shows that we prefer voices which are rich, smooth, warm, like hot chocolate. But if that's not you, that's not the end of the world. Because you can train. Go get a voice coach. And there are amazing things you can do with breathing, with posture, with exercises to improve the timbre of your voice. Then prosody. I love prosody. This is the sing-song, the meta-language that we use in order to impart meaning. It's root one for meaning in conversation. People who speak all on one note are really quite hard to listen to if they don't have any prosody at all. That's where the word monotonic comes from, or monotonous, monotone. Also, we have repetitive prosody now coming in, where every sentence ends as if it were a question, when it's actually not a question, it's a statement. And if you repeat that one over and over, it's actually restricting your ability to communicate through prosody, which I think is a shame. So let's try and break that habit. Pace. I can get very, very excited by saying something really, really quickly, or I can slow right down to emphasize. And at the end of that, of course, is our old friend, silence. There's nothing wrong with a bit of silence in a talk, is there? We don't have to fill it with ums and ahs. Can be very powerful. Of course, pitch often goes along with pace to indicate arousal, but you can do it just with pitch. Where did you leave my keys? Where did you leave my keys? It's a slightly different meaning in those two deliveries. And finally, volume. I can get really excited by using volume, sorry about that, if I startled anybody, or I can have you really pay attention, like it's very quiet. Some people broadcast the whole time, try not to do that. That's called softcasting. Imposing your sound on people around you carelessly and inconsiderately, not nice. Of course, where this all comes into play most of all is when you've got something really important to do. It might be standing on a stage like this and giving a talk to people. It might be proposing marriage, asking for a raise, a wedding speech, whatever it is. If it's really important, you owe it to yourself to look at this toolbox and the engine that it's going to work on. And no engine works well without being warmed up. Warm up your voice. Actually, let me show you how to do that. Would you all like to stand up?
Okay, gentlemen, let's go. Okay, everybody stand up.
I'm going to show you the six free vocal warm-up exercises.
It doesn't take long.
I do before every talk I ever do. Anytime you're going to talk to anybody important, do these. First, arms up. Deep breath in and sigh out. Like that. One more time. Very good. Now we're going to warm up our lips and we're going to go bop, 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 bop. And now, just like when you're a kid. Now your lips should be coming alive. We're going to do the tongue next. With exaggerated la la la
la la la la la la la la la,
and then roll an R. That's like champagne for the tongue. Finally, and if I can only do one, the pros call this the siren. It's really good. It starts with we and goes to or. The we is high, the or is low. So you go we.
We.
Fantastic. Give yourselves a round of applause. Do those in advance. Now, let me just put this in context to close. This is a serious point here. This is where we are now, right? We speak not very well into people who simply aren't listening in an environment that's all about noise and acoustics. I have talked about that on this stage in different phases. What would the world be like if we were speaking powerfully to people who are listening consciously in environments which were actually fit for purpose? Or to make that a bit larger, What would the world be like if we were creating sound consciously and consuming sound consciously and designing all our environments consciously for sound? That would be a world that does sound beautiful, and one where understanding would be the norm, and that is an idea worth spreading. Thank you.
That was good. Okay, Julian Treasure, that was really good. Now, what I like so much about that brief presentation is that he gives you a sense of some of the deeper elements of classical rhetorical theory, which we will touch upon a little bit in this course, but it will not be a major element. But for today, one of the, you know, we should understand that rhetoric, essentially what we're doing right here, gentlemen, this is possibly one of the oldest curricular elements in advanced education. It goes all the way back to the Greek and Roman days, the Periclean era, where you had groups of scholars who were expert in saying things. Not necessarily in believing things, not necessarily in arguing for things, but in being able to express an idea, and you would hire them to do your bidding. And if you wanted to have some political gain, wanted to have some monetary gain, you would hire one of these very well-trained experts in speaking to do your will. Plato and Socrates, really, more than Plato, his teacher, argued against this misuse of this very special skill that we have as human beings. And this is the birth of modern rhetorical theory, or I should say classical rhetorical theory, which addresses what exactly is it when we're speaking. And they usually divide it into three basic elements. Logos, oops, let's get the pen here. I like the pen. Logos, pathos, and ethos. Now, I've translated them roughly down here. Logos, which you may see that word in a lot of disciplines like psychology or biology. Logos is the Greek word for word, but it usually means in this context science or ideas. Logic is related to it. Logos is more like what we're talking about when we say content. What exactly is the information, the ideas that you are conveying in your speech? Pathos, you may have heard the phrase or the word pathetic, right? Pathos means emotion. Pathos conveys like the depth of feeling that goes along with the logos. So a speech has both logic and emotion in it. And finally, ethos, and this is what I liked about Julian Treasure's presentation, and I really think it's very important for us here in particular. You know, you're going to go out into the world in a very short period of time, and you are going to be representing the entire Jewish people, me included, in all kinds of contexts. Even when you're riding the train, even when you are, you know, shopping for groceries, whatever it is, people are going to look at you and say, there's a Jew. How does he speak? Once you start speaking, you represent all of us. So we really have to make sure we focus on ethos, which refers to integrity. He touches on it in that video when he talks about how, you know, don't argue for things you don't believe in. Don't try to misrepresent positions to abuse people's intelligence. You know, it's a really important element, and that's why we will be talking politics a lot. Not only because politicians do a lot of speaking, but also because politicians tend to do a lot of unethical speaking. Now, we're not going to espouse any particular political position, but we will be definitely looking at a lot of politician speeches and analyzing, you know, what do they say for the art of rhetoric as a whole. Any questions about this classical rhetorical theory stuff? No. When I'm gone, you guys can play with this board if you like. It's actually a lot of fun. Oh, wait, I have a rubber eraser. That's even better, but I like to use my finger. Okay, let's go on. Okay, so what we're gonna do today, this speech or introduction, right? That's me. Okay, I'm gonna give you the advanced stuff of what I want you to do today and in preparation for our next class Monday. And then I'm going to do my speech of introduction, and I expect you to grade me. Okay, so get ready. Here we go. What we're talking about is a 3-minute maximum speech, but since they're a little larger than I expected, let's make it a 2-minute maximum speech. And by the way, gentlemen, I'm letting you know up front, I will be savage. I will cut you off at the end of the period, whether you like it or not. That's it. Okay, so stay within your time. One of the worst things a speaker can do is speak too much. Right? Brevity is the very soul of wit. And I'd like you to speak for, let's say, up to 2 minutes, who you are and what you are about. You're just going to introduce yourself to the rest of us. We're going to be in this little capsule here for a few hours, Monday through Thursday for a few weeks. So this is your opportunity to say your name. We will use surnames here, of course. And what's important about you? Who is you? We talked about the grading, so I don't have to do that. Here's the last thing. I need you all to set up a Prezi account. It's prezi.com. If you use your Turo email, your student email, you'll be able to get a free account without advertising, which is a nice thing. And one of the elements of this course there's a technology piece. By the end of the course, I expect you all to be using Prezis in your presentations. PowerPoint is like so 20th century, we're not even gonna think about that. Let me show you online a little bit about how to get to the things you'll need for this class. So everybody knows how to log into Turo 1. Have you done that yet? Okay, so you log into Turo 1, you click on Blackboard here like this, and then it'll take you to several classes. You go to SPLN 101, which is this course. Under getting started, there are some helpful things on what you need to do, like kind of general for this an academic integrity statement. The syllabus is here on this page, and the ISBN and other information with the required textbook is there. If you want to reach me, there's instructor information, so on and so forth. You can check your grades here under My Grades, but let's go to Coursework by Session. And so here are each of these sessions. They are not precisely organized by our meetings. So it may take two sessions to complete one of these folders, but they are 10 units in general. And you'll see in the syllabus how they correspond to the readings. So today's session is here, and inside it you will see the link to the Prezi that we've been watching, so you can easily review it. And then here you have online live links to the surveys for each of us. Many of you just registered in the last hour or so before the class, so I don't have your name up there yet. What we're going to have to do for today is please take notes on paper, and once we're done this class, I'll upload them later tonight. You can go online and add them in. And in subsequent classes, we should have everybody online, so you'll be able to do it live. Let's look at mine, for example. And since I'm speaking first, that makes sense. You can even look at it. You click on it, and you'll see a little Qualtrics survey. It is actually optimized for phones, so it's really convenient to do it right online. There's only three questions. Each of them is divided into two. The first is assess the content of the presentation, and you could choose weak, acceptable, or strong. Well, it doesn't work. Okay, I have to do it on the computer. And then provide your comments underneath. You're going to do this for each of the members of the class. And then it goes down, you click on a little red button, and it goes to the second question, the third question, and then the magic moment. Okay, we all clear as the sun at noonday? Okay, so now, gentlemen, point of order, it's 5 o'clock. How about I give my 1 to 2 minute introductory speech right now, and I guess we can take a break of 5 minutes or so, and then we're gonna race through everyone's 1 minute speech. If we finish by 5:45, which I think we should, then we can go across the street to Daven Mincha at 5:50. And if not, we have a minion here, but I think that would be ideal. So my speech, 5 minute break, and then we're gonna rush through. Okay, by the way, guys, everything's gonna be videotaped, and your speeches will be available in Blackboard as well. So you can review them, and you know, see how you looked on tape and so on. Yes?
Blackboard was in the Turo?
Yes, you go to Turo 1, it'll give you your email, and below that is Blackboard. Click on that link.
There's nothing on their announcements.
Right, I didn't announce anything yet.
I'm saying, how did you access that?
Oh, you go under Coursework by Week. Okay, gentlemen, you ready? So I would suggest you take the rubric out. You're going to have to make some notes on it in order to incorporate all the speakers today who are not, especially if you're not using your phone today. And I got my watch here ready, so I'll give you my quick introductory speech. Hi, how are you all doing? My name is Henry Abramson. That's my slave name. My Hebrew name is Hillel. I was born over five decades ago in a small town in northern Ontario. My family were the only Jews living in this tiny remote community up in Canada. And when I was a teenager, they sent me down to Toronto, which was the big city, to get my education. That's when I discovered Yiddishkeit, and it didn't stick right away. But then later when I met my wife, she and I started exploring Judaism together, and that's how I ended up growing a beard and going on to success in higher education. Actually, it's a kind of interesting thing. My wife and I were both ski instructors. That's how we met. My area of expertise is Jewish history. I wrote my first book on the Jews of Ukraine at the beginning of the 20th century, published by Harvard University. And then my third book, by the way, was published by Feldheim University on Gemara. Sorry, not Feldheim University, Feldheim Publishers. I believe I am the only person ever to be published by both Harvard and Feldheim, which I think says a lot about who I am. I have another book forthcoming actually next month on the Rambam, Hilchas Tshuva. It's a commentary in English. And my major research right now is on Piasechna Hasidus, which is a 20th century Hasidic movement associated with central Poland. I didn't think too much in advance about what I was going to say to you guys, so I think I'm not going to get such a great grade. But I am really grateful to be here, and I look forward to learning with you over the course of this semester.